So glad you made it. Welcome to this place.
Welcome to the weekly worship experience from the St. Paul Church in Oxon Hill. We're so glad you made it, and we thank you for joining us this week. Thank you for having us in your homes. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We want to get ready to worship. We want to get ready to praise. We want to wash away last week and prepare ourselves for next week, because God is always able, God is always working, and God will make a way. Let's pray together right now. Father in heaven, we say thank you. Lord, we thank you because you brought us through another week. And Lord, we say thank you because we've got great expectations for the week to come. Lord, we know that you've been our provider. You've been our way maker. And Lord, we thank you for blessing us. Lord, right now, we just ask that you continue to bless us, Lord. We ask that you look beyond our faults and see our needs. We ask right now, Lord, as we prepare for worship and as we prepare for praise, that what we do will be acceptable in your sight. Lord, we don't want to worship in vain. We want to worship in spirit and in truth. So Lord, send your spirit. Let it alight with us. Bind us heart to heart, even in our several homes, so that we may worship you together right here and right now. Lord, we thank you, and Lord, we praise you, and Lord, we're ready to hear from you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's get started now with this song of praise.
Worthy of all my praise, for he
Amen. It's Palm Sunday. Woohoo! We want to wave our palms. I hope you got your palms. It was good to see how many people came by yesterday to pick up their palms in preparation for Palm Sunday. This is Palm Sunday, the day that Jesus made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. I hope you're enjoying your Palm Sunday. I hope you've got your palms, because this is a day that only happens once a year, the high holy day of the church that we love to celebrate. Listen, I want to make sure that you're staying connected to everything that we do at the church. To stay connected to what we do here at the St. Paul Church, you've got to make sure you're getting the St. Paul eBlast. The eBlast is our official organ of communications. It comes out 3 times a week and with breaking news in between. You can expect 3 times. Monday, you'll get the week ahead. On Wednesday, you'll get the deeper dive, which is our sermon review and enhancement materials. And on Friday, you'll get the weekend ahead, prepping you for everything that's going on in the ministry. We don't want you to miss a thing. So make sure you're getting the eBlast. If you're not signed up for it, just go to our website, www.stpauloxenhill.org, and press the Contact Us button and say, I want the eBlast. We also want you following us on social media. We're on Facebook and we're on Instagram. And if you join us on Facebook, you can join the St. Paul E-Village, which is our little behind the scenes place where we can pray for each other, talk with each other, and do it out of public light, because we want to be community for one another. So make sure you're following us on Instagram, Facebook, and that you're a part of the St. Paul E-Village. Also, I want to let you know, our food pantry continues to be open and doing amazing work. So if you need food or know somebody that does, we want you to come and get a distribution from the St. Paul Food Pantry. To get a distribution, we distribute on Thursdays. All you gotta do is call the church and make an appointment, and we will be prepared for you when you show up. We distribute in a socially distanced manner, and you certainly don't have to be a member of the church. But if you need food or know somebody that does, call the church, make an appointment, and receive a distribution from the St. Paul Food Pantry. Listen, right now, I want you to watch this video.
All right, folks. Here we go, folks. Last dose. Oh, and it did not hurt a bit. Everything seems to be fine. Vaccine is going in. It's up to all of us to do our part to make sure that all of us can make it through.
That's right.
So y'all know I hate needles. If I can do it, so can you.
Yes, that was me getting my second dose of the vaccine. Like I said when I got the first dose, we want to get the world, our church, and everybody else back to normal. But more than anything else, we want to save lives and keep people safe. What I can tell you right now is that I've gotten the vaccine. I haven't had any ill side effects. It's been safe. It's been almost normal. It was like getting a shot. But I want to encourage you to make sure that if you can, that you get vaccinated. In the eBlast, we will be putting out ways and places where you can get vaccinated. Listen, the vaccine saves lives. And because it disproportionately affects our community, I want to make sure that our community is vaccinated. So join me in getting your vaccinations, because vaccines save lives. Today is Palm Sunday, and Palm Sunday is the beginning of Holy Week, and our Holy Week is going to be awesome here at the St. Paul Church this week. We've been doing several wonderful things, and we've got a couple extras this week. Of course, we're continuing in our Lent talks. Our Lent talks have been awesome. I want to thank Pastor Joseph Robinson, who joined us last week to talk about making the Bible real in your life. But this week, we have another guest for our Lent talks. This guest will be Dr. Cassandra Lewis of Lewis Executive Coaching. Why are we bringing an executive coach? Very simple. You know, many times we can do something during Lent, but it's very difficult to make it a part of our ongoing life. Dr. Lewis coaches executives on how to make positive change in their lives. So this week, what Dr. Lewis is going to be talking to us about is how to make Lent more than a season, but a part of your ongoing life. So if the things that you've done in Lent you want to make ongoing, your Bible reading, your praying, your fasting, your meditation, if you want to make those an ongoing part of your life, not just 40 days, join us this week as Dr. Cassandra Lewis of Lewis Executive Coaching tells us how to make permanent changes in our lives. Also, want to remind you, we continue, this week is our last week of 40 Days in the Holy Spirit by Dr. R.T. Kendall. We want you to join us on Thursday for our discussion group. That'll be Thursday at 7 p.m. All you got to do is go online and register if you haven't been coming and you want to be there for the last session. But if you have been coming, you're already registered, and we'll see you Thursday at 7 p.m. Also, this week is Good Friday. So Good Friday, we typically have seven last word services. Because we're doing social distancing, we're going to be having virtual seven last word services. This year, we'll be in 2 7 last words. At 12 noon, we'll be joining the Westphalia Church, Westphalia United Methodist, pastored by our friend, the Reverend Dr. Timothy West. And they will be streaming the seven last word service that I'm preaching at online starting at 12 noon. Tomorrow in the e-blast, we will have the link to that service because we want you to join us. Then join us at 7 p.m. when we'll be doing another seven last words. This year, we're joining the Kingdom Fellowship AME Church in Silver Spring, which is pastored by my good friend, Reverend Matthew Lawrence Watley. At 7 p.m., we'll be doing seven last words with them. Again, we will have the links available for you in tomorrow's e-blast because we want to make sure that we see your face in the place as we go through this high holy week of Passion Week. Listen, next week is Easter Sunday, and I'm so excited about it. On Easter Sunday, it is our tradition to have a sunrise service. So next week, along with our 8 o'clock service, our 10:30 service, and our noon service, we will be having a 6:30 a.m. sunrise service in celebration of Easter. I'd love to have you join us at 6:30 so we can celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and our King. As always, we'll be praying this week. And we'll be praying on the St. Paul Prayer Call. The St. Paul Prayer Call takes place at 7:30 a.m. Monday through Friday. And we want you to join us. To join us, all you gotta do is call the St. Paul Prayer Line. The number for the prayer line is 605-313-5874. And the access code is 390060. Like we always say, there's no better way to start your day than in prayer and praise with the people of the St. Paul Church. So meet us Monday through Friday at 7:30 a.m. on the St. Paul Prayer Call. As you know, during the Lenten season, we've been giving an extra offering. We've been giving an extra $10 a week to the Lenten offering to help directly people in the community. And I thank you for your generosity. I thank all of you who have been giving. It's been so meaningful, and it prepares us to be a blessing to others. This week is the last week of our Lenten offerings, so I want to encourage you to give again this week. And I thank all of you who have been giving ongoingly above and beyond your tithes and offerings, that sacrificial gift of $10 a week. So I thank you for that, but I also thank you for your ongoing tithes and offerings. Those ongoing tithes and offerings are what allow us to continue doing ministry, allow us to keep our edifice together while we're in this time of social distancing, but also so we can be prepared for when we come back for in-person worship. I thank you for your generosity. It makes us a strong church. It makes us a vital church, and it makes us a church that can do the work of God. Let's now prepare for offering. It's offering time in the house of God. Here at the St. Paul Church, there are multiple ways that you can give. You can give by clicking on the link on the screen in front of you. You can also give by going to our website, www.stpauloxenhill.org, and pressing the Give tab. You can give by using your cell phone, by using the Givelify app. On the Givelify app, all you've got to do is search for St. Paul Church in Oxon Hill, and you'll find a picture of me and a picture of the church so you know you're giving to the right place. And then in 3 easy, secure steps, you can give directly to the St. Paul Church. Last, but certainly not least, you can always mail your tithes and offerings to the St. Paul Church. All you got to do is mail them to St. Paul Church, 6634 St. Barnabas Road, Oxon Hill, Maryland, 20745, Attention Finance Ministry. Any of those ways will let you bless God and bless the church. And we know the Bible tells us, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you've decided in your hearts to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, let's give abundantly unto the Lord.
Father, I pray, order my in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Quiet my tongue, let the words edify. Let the words of my mouth be acceptable in thy sight. Take charge of my thoughts both day.
In your world, when I need a brand new.
I want to thank the music department for that awesome selection. That's absolutely one of my favorite songs. Let's get into the word right now. Turn with me in your Bibles, if you have them with you, to the Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter, and I'll be reading for you verses 1 through 11. And this is what the Holy Scripture says. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. This is the story of Palm Sunday and Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. This is one of the things that is in all of the Gospels, all four, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all record their versions of the triumphal entry, which lets you know that it's incredibly important. It's one of the high holy days of the church. It's where we get Palm Sunday from. It was this celebration of Jesus, the coming king, walking into the city of Jerusalem and the crowds acknowledging him. The same Jesus who, depending on the gospel, told people, don't tell people that I'm the coming king. Don't tell people who I am. Don't tell people I'm the Son of God. Now he's making his grand debut. There's a large parade and he's walking in and people are shouting and waving palms, and he's riding in on a donkey, and everybody sees it, and it's a wonderful production. But here's the thing. When I look at this, and when you look at all of the gospel writings around it, I realize that there were only two beings that were necessities for this to happen. Yeah, we had the disciples, and yeah, we had the crowd, and yeah, we had the Pharisees and the Sadducees. We had all of Jerusalem turning out, but you really only needed two. You needed the main character and a supporting character. Oftentimes, we don't realize that supporting characters are as important as main characters. If you've ever seen a movie, you remember the main character, but we often forget some of the supporting roles. My wife gets upset with me because whenever we go to, well, back when we went to the movies to watch movies, you know, between COVID and child, we just don't get out to do that terribly much anymore. She would be upset because I would watch all the credits, like the theater's emptying out, and I would just sit there and watch it roll. I would watch the entire cast. I would watch the entire film crew. I would watch all of it until you got to the end where they would thank whatever city they were in, and that would be the end of the credits. I would do that because I've had friends in the movie industry. One of them is our own cameraman, Reggie. And I know that everybody had a part in putting this movie together. It's not just the big name on the screen. It's not just that lead person, but everybody had something to do. Oftentimes, we focus on the main character and we miss the supporting roles. We so focus on the main character and don't realize everything that went into it. And we also sometimes don't realize that to be a good supporting character makes you a professional and makes you good at what you do. I think of Denzel Washington often. You know, Denzel is the man, probably one of the best actors of his generation. But Denzel did not start off as Denzel! Denzel started off as a supporting character. Before Denzel became a Best Actor nominee, before he became a Best Actor awardee, Denzel played minor characters in films. And he played them so well that before he was a Best Actor nominee, he was nominated to be Best Supporting Actor twice and won one of them once. Denzel worked his way from support into the main role. And here's the question that I have for you on this Sunday morning, on this Palm Sunday. The real question is, can you play a supporting role? The real question is, do you have to be the star or can you be the secondary character? The reason I ask this, and I want you to hear my sermon topic right now. The question for today, my sermon topic is, can you be a donkey? Can you be a donkey? You see, playing a supporting role is not about taking shine away from the main character. It's about doing your part well without trying to make it about you. It's about doing your part well, but not trying to steal the light from the main character. It's about being able to be in the background, but be so good at it that it makes everything else work. And what I want you to understand today is that too many of us are not interested in being involved if it's not about us. We're not interested in being involved if our name isn't first. We're not interested in being involved if we're not the center of attention. And what I want you to know today is that there are going to be times in life when the requirement is for you to be the supporting character, not the lead character. If the requirement is going to be that you stand in the back or stand on the side or do something that no one ever sees, but your part is an important part. I want you to understand, a supporting role is not an unimportant role. Many of us saw the movie Glory, one of those Denzel movies, and we remember Denzel being whipped. And y'all remember he was holding on to the thing and they saw the scars on his back and Denzel did the famous one tear. Y'all know, we've seen that so often that it's become a meme and it's so memorable. But remember, Denzel's a supporting character in that movie. Supporting roles doesn't mean unimportant or unnoticed. It just means that you don't have to be the one all the way out front. It happens in sports too. You know, I love basketball, and what I love is sometimes watching the role players in basketball. One of my favorite teams ever. Now, I'm a suffering Knicks fan, but like everybody else, I enjoyed the running of the Bulls in the 90s. When Mike and the boys up in Chicago were killing the game. And listen, there was only one Michael Jordan on the team, but everybody on the team was needed. You needed Pippen to distribute the ball and stretch the floor. You needed Rodman to do defense and rebounding. You needed Stephen Kerr to hit open threes and to hit spot up and hit open shots. You needed Tony Kukoc to be a slasher. You needed Bill Winnington to just be tall and serve no other purpose. Everybody had a role, and because everybody played their role, those Bulls went 72-10 and won the championship in record time. What I want you to know, every role isn't going to be glamorous, but every role is necessary. And sometimes you got to look to yourself and say, God, are you calling me to play or support? Are you calling me to be a role player and not to be the star? What I want you to know, on Palm Sunday, there were two people who were necessary for Palm Sunday to happen. It was Jesus and a donkey. Jesus was the star, but the donkey was absolutely necessary. And many of us wouldn't have wanted to be the donkey, but let me show you why the donkey was necessary. Matthew 21, 1 through 11, it starts off by saying, when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. Look at what Jesus is doing. He requires them, before we enter Jerusalem, go get me a donkey and a colt. Now, why would he say, go get me a donkey and a colt? Understand, they've been in ministry for 3 years, and for 3 years, they've been roaming the countryside. They've been here, there, and everywhere. They've been healing the sick, raising the dead, giving sight to the blind. Jesus has been preaching. He's been sharing. He went back to his hometown. He went to Galilee. He's gone everywhere. He's gone to this place, that place, and the other place. He's gone to Capernaum. He's been walking around the sea. They've been on boat rides. They've been on a cruise. They've done all these things, and it was all leading to this moment that they were going to go into Jerusalem. They were going to go into the big city. They were going to announce the coming of the king. And Jesus says, we can't do that till you get me a donkey. You can't do that till you go into this town and get me a donkey. Now understand why. He says, if anyone says anything to you, tell them the Lord needs it and they'll send it at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." In other words, the donkey had to be there to fulfill the prophecy. The Bible tells us in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, "Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." I want you to understand, the donkey was absolutely necessary. You don't get Jesus confirming who he is. You don't get the star Jesus coming in and showing that he is the coming king unless you find the donkey to carry him. I want you to know that sometimes in life, ain't nothing wrong with being a donkey. The donkey was necessary. The donkey was absolutely essential, but he was still a donkey. Here's my question. Are you prepared to be a donkey? Are you prepared to be necessary but not highlighted? And this is what I want you to understand. Being necessary sometimes has to be good enough. I want you to know, when God made you, he had a plan, and God made you completely necessary to what he was trying to do. God made you completely necessary to where he was trying to go. God made you completely necessary to what he was trying to do in the world. You're necessary to your family. You're necessary to your friends. You're necessary to your church. You're necessary to the plan of God. You're part of the plan. And what you've got to understand is that when you're part of the plan, you don't have to have the big role. You've just got to necessary role. You're in the plan. Let me help you out. The donkey was in the plan. You're not an afterthought. You're not something that came up at the last minute. God has a plan for you and a plan for your life. You just have to wait your turn patiently. Here's the problem. Many of us are fighting so hard to get to the big stage that we can't just patiently wait for what God is trying to do. We can't just patiently wait for where God is trying to move us to. We just can't patiently wait knowing that our time will come, because we're fighting for the spotlight. I want to free somebody today. You don't have to fight for the spotlight. There's a role for you that God already had. Understand, Zechariah was 100 years before. Actually, it was more than 100 years before. And he prophesied this, making the donkey absolutely necessary before there was a donkey. But here's the thing. When God has a plan, God will put it in motion 100 years before, 400 years before, and he will make everything come to fruition because you're part of the plan. God makes you with intention and purpose, but here's the thing, you got to stay patient. We want it all now. We want to be up front. We want to be the big shot, but here's the problem. Fighting for the spotlight will get you out of position. Fighting for the spotlight will get you out of what God is trying to do. This is what I want you to know. If you're going to try to be the donkey, here's your first lesson. You got to stay put. Yeah, you got to stay put. Understand, the Lord knows where you are when he needs you. Sometimes to be the role player you have to be in the plan the way God needs you, you've got to learn to stay put so you can be put in the game and be a part of the plan. How many times have you been out of position and missed your opportunity? I remember when I was in high school, when I was playing football, I worked my way into being a starter. And this is how I worked my way into being a starter. Now, I wasn't no superstar, but here's the thing. Well, you know, I became real good over time. I'm just saying what I'm saying. But I worked my way into it, and this is how it happened. We had thrown an interception. And we had to switch offense and defense, and I was standing next to the coach. And the guy who played starting left cornerback was nowhere to be found. The coach looked, and they were short of cornerback. He said, 33, that was me, get in. I was like, cool. And I ran on and defended a touchdown. You know, I got dapped up by the opposing coach. He was like, man, you good. I was like, well, I tried my best. And here's the thing. I got in because I stayed put. I took the job of a guy who was supposed to be there, but he couldn't sit still. I want you to understand that sometimes you're running around and you're missing the opportunities of God because you simply can't stay put. You've got to be willing to stay still until you get your chance. What you got to understand, notice, Jesus told them, when y'all go in the village, you're going to find a donkey tied up. Some of you feel tied up right now. Let me explain something to you. God isn't, you're not tied up. God has tied you down so he'll know where to find you. You're not tied up. You're not missing out. You're not missing opportunities. This is what you have to understand about those donkeys. Had they not been tied up, they'd have been running around somewhere. Here's what it is. A donkey's favorite pastime is rolling around in the dirt. I've seen it before. This is what donkeys do. They get down, they roll in the dirt, having themselves a wonderful old time. And it's hard to get them back once they've gone off to play. Here it is. They're tied up so that they can be found. I want you to know, you feel like you're restrained. You feel like you're being held back. The truth of the matter is, God has you tied up so he'll know where to find you. Because if he doesn't tie you up, you may show up anywhere. You may be out of position when it's time for your role to show up. Understand something. You're not tied up. You're reserved. Let me explain to you what I mean. Back when I used to travel more, I had gotten to the place where I started using the same rental car company over and over again. So I had gotten to a tier of rental car. So when I show up at the airport, I didn't have to go to the desk. I didn't have to do a whole bunch of stuff. I would go to the reserved lane. And in the reserve lane, there would be my name in lights over a car. Now, they could literally be out of cars, but there was one reserved for me. I want you to understand. God is looking to reserve some folk for his purposes. God is looking to reserve some folk for his uses. God is looking to reserve some folk so that when everybody else is gone, you've been reserved so that you can play the role that God has for you. Don't think you're tied up. Don't think you're tied down. Baby, you're special. You're reserved. But here's the thing. You got to be able to stay put, but you also got to stay ready. Oftentimes, we don't realize that the best thing you can do is be ready to serve. Understand, donkeys are beasts of burden. Beasts of burden simply means that they are animals used for carrying loads. They're used for moving things from place to place. In other words, their purpose is to carry things. Here's the thing. When Jesus needed to be carried into Jerusalem, he went and found a donkey, but he didn't go find a war horse. Let me help you. Oftentimes, kings would ride back triumphantly in a triumphant entries back after a war on a war horse. The war horse would be a large, powerful horse ridden into battle. But here's the thing. Jesus came to show the battle is already won. So he rides in humbly, according to prophecy, on a donkey, on a beast of burden, on a donkey who can't fight, a donkey who can't run. All he does is carry. Here it is. You got to understand, your gifts are designed for you to serve for what you've been built for. Too often, we got donkeys who want to be war horses. I need you to understand, you got to be a donkey because donkeys were built to serve. Donkeys were built to be good. Donkeys were built to serve a purpose. And you thought you weren't good enough. You thought you needed to be a war horse. You thought you needed to change everything. The truth of the matter is, you're good enough because the glory of God is in serving. The glory of God is in doing what God has called you to do. The glory of God is in being prepared to serve the Lord, serve God, and do the things of God. You ain't got to be a war horse. You can be a donkey if you're willing to play your role. Never underestimate the specificity of your anointing. Pastor, what do you mean? You're anointed for what role God has for you, not what role you think you want. And all too often, we will want to be anointed for something that we were not anointed for. The anointing is the blessing to be able to have the ability to perform what God has set out for you. Do not despise your anointing because it's not flashy. It's not flashy, it's specific. And here's why it's specific. Because if you don't do your part, then something else falls apart. I want somebody to know, you may think that you're not doing enough as a mother, but if you don't do your part, something falls apart. You may not think you're doing enough as a father, but if you don't do your part, something else falls apart. You may think that they don't appreciate you at your job, but if you don't do your part, something else falls apart. I want you to know, you don't have to be flashy. Just do your part. Just do what God is calling you to do. Just stay on your assignment because you keep everything rolling because that's your role. But here it is. You got to know that you're in the plan. You got to stay put. You got to stay ready. But you also got to stay humble. This is the hard one. You have to be okay with it not being about you. You have to be content to do what you were called to do. One of the best stories of contentment in the Bible is the story of John the Baptist. John the Baptist, when Jesus comes on the scene, says, "I must decrease so that he may increase." In other words, John says, "Look, I was just the warm-up act. I need to fall back." Here's what I want you to know. Too often, we can't do what God is calling us to do because we're not humble enough to just serve in that capacity until we're elevated. And let me help you out with something. You may never get elevated, and you need to be happy with that too, because elevation comes from God serving, from you serving God. It comes from you serving your purpose. You can't just be sitting around saying, "When I get to the next level, they gonna see. When I blow up, they gonna see. When I get the blow up and the glow up, they gonna see." Maybe your role is right here. And watch this. You're missing the joy of this trying to be that. Here it is. The donkey never tried to be Jesus. The donkey just played his role. You have to say, you don't have to seek the light. You don't have to seek the shine. Shine doing what you're created to do. You ain't got to call attention to yourself. We live in a society that is so attention starved that people get on the internet and do all types of crazy things so they can make a name, build a brand, get a following. You don't need a brand. You don't need following. You need an audience of one, and that one is God on high. If you do what you're called to, if you do what God created you for, you will be able to function in your anointing in a way that from the balconies of heaven, God will look down and say, "That boy good. That girl good." But while you're running around trying to get the attention of man, you're losing favor with God. I want you to understand that humility allows you to say, "If this is what God has for me, this is how I'm going to roll. I'm just going to play my role. I'm going to play my part." And here it is. When you play your part, you ain't got to be nobody else. I'm always disappointed when I see folk who look alike. You know, they wear the same clothes. They do their makeup the same way. You would think they was related because they've all decided this is how we have to be. This is how we have to look. And what I want you to understand, when you function in your anointing, when you function in your role, all you got to do is be you. You won't have to build a brand. You won't have to build a following. You'll be able to be you and be seen for being you and be noticed for being you, because you'll be functioning in what God called you to do. Because the only way you can do that is to know it's not about you. So you got to know you're part of the plan. Stay put, stay ready, stay humble, and last, stay connected. Throughout this entire story, Jesus never leaves the donkey. When you're serving, when you're playing your role, stay connected to the main character, and Jesus is always the main character. In your supporting role, your job is to do the work of Jesus. And here it is, because the donkey serves, Jesus stays connected to him at all times, and he stays connected to the donkey. Jesus never gets off the donkey. Here it is, Jesus wants you to understand, John chapter 15, verse 5, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me stays connected to me, and I in him stays connected to him. He it is that bears much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." Here it is. I want you to know the donkey wasn't important if he wasn't connected to Jesus. I want you to know you've got to stay connected to the Lord so that you can know how important you are. You've got to stay connected to the Lord so you can know your identity. You've got to stay connected to the Lord so you can be in the story. You've got to stay connected to the Lord so that when they see the main character, they'll see you too. Because when they see you, they should see Jesus. All you got to do is stay connected to him. You'll bear fruit. Stay connected to him. You'll live in the overflow. Stay connected to him. You'll do your job with joy. Stay connected to him. You'll be noticed for what you're doing. Stay connected to him. But here's the thing. When you live in the overflow, watch this, you get the donkey's reward. Let me help. The reason you can be the donkey is because the donkey lives in the overflow. Everything that happened for Jesus that day happened with the donkey too. When they came down the Mount of Olives and they were shouting Hosanna, the donkey was there. Every time they rolled by and they yelled Hosanna to Jesus, the donkey heard, and I believe the donkey's ears perked up. Every time that they waved a palm branch, the donkey could see the palm branches being waved, and the donkey could get it confused and think it was about him, but he knew it was about Jesus. But here it is, the thing about overflow is that you can be celebrated while he's doing the work. You can be celebrated while you're attached to him and doing what he's called you to do. You get to be a part of the celebration. The donkey walked on every garment that was laid out for Jesus. The donkey saw every palm branch that was raised. The donkey wasn't a king. He wasn't a main character, but he was able to be in the overflow. I want you to know you got to make the decision that you can be the donkey. You got to make the decision that you can just be there and play your role, do your part, and stay connected to the Lord. You're in the plan, so stay put, stay ready, stay humble, stay connected, and God will put you in the story. God's plan started a long time ago, and he's always had a part for you in it. God's plan started a long time ago, and he always had a role for you to play. All you got to do is stay in, stay connected, stay with God. Give your life to God. Connect with Jesus, and you'll get put in the plan and put in the game. Stay put. Stay ready. Stay humble. Stay connected. And I promise you, you'll be in God's grand story. But the question still remains, can you be the donkey? Hey, I hope that sermon enlivened your mind, opened your heart, and moved you closer to God. If the sermon had an impact on you, why don't you consider the following? Try becoming a part of the St. Paul family. We'd love to have you. To be a part of our family, just join us here every week and watch our broadcast. Follow us on social media. We're on Instagram. We're on Facebook. All you got to do is come and join us, or go to our website and keep up with all that's going on. We want to be connected to you, and we want you to be connected to us. Also, share this word. All you got to do, copy the link, send it to friends, send it to family, post it on your social media. We want to do the kingdom business of spreading the word of God as far and wide as we can, and you can help us with that. Also, would you consider supporting the St. Paul Ministries? We'd love to have your support. It doesn't matter how much you give. You can give a lot, you can give a little, whatever the Lord leads your heart to, because we're just trying to spread the word of God so that people can get closer to God and have the lives that he intended. If you want to support our ministry, just go to www.stpauloxenhill.org and press the Give tab. Listen, we love you. We're glad you were here. And now it's time for the Williams Weekly Challenge. The Word of God tells us not only be hearers of the Word, but also doers of the Word. This week, I've got a special challenge for you. Have you ever been in a situation where it wasn't all about you? Oftentimes in life, things are about us. We're the main star, we're the main character, we're the centerpiece. But there will be times in life when you have to play the background, when you have to play a different role. This week, my challenge to you is don't make it about you this week. This week, play a supporting role. Find somebody that needs your help, support them, lift them, and help them. This week's weekly challenge, help somebody else. God bless you. I love you, and we'll see you next time.